So good evening and welcome to this joint meeting of City Council and School Committee convened by, in accordance with Northampton Charter, Section 7-2, annual budget policy. I'll begin by asking the clerk to call the roll of the two bodies.
Counselor Adams.
Here.
Counselor Dwight.
Here.
Counselor Carney.
Present.
Counselor Bidwell.
Here.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Here.
Counselor Shara.
Here.
Counselor Labarge.
Present.
Counselor Klein. School Committee Member Burnham.
Here.
School Committee Member Reed.
Here.
School Committee Member Busansky.
Present.
School Committee Member Fallon.
Present.
School Committee Member Moore.
Here.
School Committee Member Zukowski.
Present.
School Committee Member Hennessy.
Present.
School Committee Member Baird.
Here.
School Committee Member Meyer.
Here.
Okay, we have a quorum. If you would start the slideshow. So good evening, everyone. Tonight I am going to do a review of our city's financial condition. This is in accordance with the charter, which I'm required to do every year as we prepare to begin the FY17 budget process. So I've prepared a number of slides. Some of them we'll just go through quickly. If we can go to the next slide, this is just a brief agenda of the things I want to try to cover this evening. If you may want to turn the front lights down, it might make it easier for people to see. Is that okay? Is that easier to see?
Yes.
So just a quick agenda, doing some comparisons with neighboring communities, which we've looked at in the past, reviewing our revenue and expenditure trends, reviewing our five-year fiscal stability plan, where we are, and then revenue and expenditure projections for the upcoming fiscal year, and then a review of the budget calendar, and then time, obviously, for Q&A. You can go to the next slide. So in terms of financial indicators, on the left you'll see we have the comparison communities that we like to look at. It includes the other medium-sized cities here in the valley, as well as some towns, East Hampton and Amherst, together with Longmeadow, which are also in some ways good comparables for us. And then we have a number of things we're going to quickly look at in terms of where we are, how we stack up. In terms of several financial indicators. You can go to the next slide. So our single family home average value, you can see that the average state average of a single family home is $383,606. And then you can see where Northampton fits in there. We're in the lighter color, just over $300,000. And you can sort of see the full range of a single home average value. That's obviously important as we begin to look at the next slides, which is our tax rate. So if you go to the next slide, please. This is the residential tax rates. This is the per $1,000 tax rate. You can see across the board, everywhere from Longmeadow, which is $24.33 per thousand, which actually holds the distinction of being the highest residential tax rate in the Commonwealth, all the way over to Northampton, which is $16.16. We do denote at the bottom several of the communities has an asterisk, and those are communities that have a split tax rate, meaning they have a separate commercial and residential rate. If you want to go to the next slide. Then we looked at the commercial tax rate. And again, that's where you see this split differential. And you can see Northampton, again, with our single tax rate, $16.16, and where we stack up in terms of our per $1,000 tax rate. You can go to the next slide. Now, you can look at the tax rate, but then you also have to look at, property values and how it calculates out in terms of what the average single family tax bill is. This shows where Northampton fits in on that scale, $4,865 being the average single family tax bill in Northampton. And of course, Longmeadow over there is $7,977, all the way down to Chicopee, which is $2,900. So that's sort of the range of where people come in on those. Next slide. Median household income. The state average is $67,846. And you can see that Northampton is, just above the middle of the pack, $58,179. Next slide. This is actually a really interesting slide. So we're still looking at those comparisons, and we have a number that's used every year called new growth. And new growth is based on the value of new construction in our community that's happened. So basically economic development, either new homes or new businesses that are built. And you can see that Northampton is far and ahead, almost 60 million in new growth. And the next nearest in terms of value of new construction is Westfield at just under 40 million. So that speaks very much to the level of economic activity and economic development that's happening here in Northampton. Go to the next slide. So this actually shows that new growth when it's applied to the levy limit. And of course, because there are some cities that have higher commercial tax rates, you see that we don't come in quite as high in terms of the actual new growth when it's applied to the levy limit. But again, we're still just under $1 million in new growth in the current fiscal year, FY 2016, which is very strong. And again, speaks to our at least the strength of our local economy. You can go to the next slide. Next, we'll take a look at some of our own internal metrics in terms of our some of our internal fund balances, the state of our reserves. This is free cash, or it's called the undesignated fund balance. This is basically at the end of every fiscal year. The state certifies how much leftover funding that we have at the end of the year, and then that goes into our reserve accounts and is typically used for either funding shortfalls that happen during the next fiscal year, or it pays for capital improvements, or we sock it away into our various reserve funds. We have been making a concerted effort to make sure that we have a strong undesignated fund balance. The DOR recommends that you be between 3.5% and 5% every year. We are right around 4% in the current fiscal year, and you can see that that's been slowly trending up because we've been making a focus on that. You can see in FY10, when we had the financial collapse, we actually had a negative balance. Several cities had a negative balance. That was because there was massive mid-year cuts in state aid that year that left many communities in the negative at the end of the year. But that's a number that's very important because that free cash helps us fund many of the capital improvement projects in both the city and the schools. Next slide. This is our general fund reserves. There's basically three funds here, and they're denoted in color. We have a general sort of stabilization account. That's the lightest color one. We then have the capital stabilization, which is the next one, the green one. And then we have the fiscal stability stabilization fund. You can see we've also been making a concerted effort to get our reserves, to restore our reserves to where they were at the peak of the recession. The bond rating agencies have been very impressed with this. This is something that they're looking at very carefully in terms of the strength of our reserves. Our goal had been to get ourselves at about 5% of the overall size of the budget, and we are now, we've achieved that, and we are now at about 8%, I believe, and we're hoping, our primary goal is to be at 10%, which is really the place that people want to see us in terms of what we have available for reserves in case of emergencies, in case of all the other contingencies that might happen, like another recession that you see that occurred in FY 10, 11, and 12. You can go to the next slide. This is just showing the stabilization funds as a percentage of the general fund budget, and you can see we're just shy of 8%. We have internal, we have sort of a fiscal policies that we try to adhere to in everything from borrowing to how we allocate our free cash into the various stabilization funds. And one of our newly revised goals is trying to achieve this 10% in our stabilization fund. So the question becomes, why is that so important? Next slide. The reason why it's important is because it does bear a direct proportion, a relationship to our bond rating. This just kind of gives you a snapshot of how our bond rating compares to some of those communities. We have an AA+ bond rating, which is the not quite the highest. I think it's a triple A plus. Very, we don't actually, I think, qualify for that given our size at this point. But AA plus is one of the strongest Standard & Poor ratings, which was just recently reaffirmed in January. And then Moody's, which we haven't been rated since 2015, we have an AA2 rating, which is really strong. And again, the reason for that, and why don't we go to the next slide? What our bond rating told us, and this was just done in December of 2015, we were going out to actually try to refund or refinance about $10 million in bonds, and Standard & Poor's did a full review of our finances. They had a meeting with a telephone meeting with myself and the finance director and our treasurer to talk about all of our financials. They noted in their report, which is a public report, that we have a strong economy, we have strong management with strong financial policies. They talked about our strong budgetary performance with operating surpluses in the general fund, that's the free cash, the strong flexibility with reserves and overrides. They looked at our past history of being able to pass overrides for debt exclusion projects, and then they looked at our debt position. Again, strong local economy. And then they say, what would what would lower our rating? And basically, if we fail to maintain that budget flexibility due to either a decline in our budget performance or if we start to lose the strength of our reserves. So let's go to the next slide. And this just further illustrates why it's so important. So this is that bond offering that we did back in December. And basically, we had a series of bonds that we were refinancing, basically, that totaled $10 million. You can see, if you can see it up above, there were three sets of bonds. The interest rates we were paying on those bonds were about 3.5, 3.4, 3.7. We went out on the bond market in January, and the average interest rate that we were able to yield was 1.36%, which will amount to, over time, a savings of just shy of $700,000 in borrowing costs. So when we're borrowing to put a new roof on schools, when we're borrowing to pave roads or to buy equipment that we need, that bond rating is critical in terms of saving money and borrowing costs. One more wonky slide on the bonds. Go ahead and this was something actually our bond folks sent to us afterwards. And there's sort of three lines there on the chart. The bottom one is Northampton. The next one up is AA rated nationally, and the other one above it is AAA rated nationally. And the takeaway of this slide is that they were actually amazed, and that's why they made the slide and sent it to us, is that investors were actually willing to take a lower return on their investment on City of Northampton bonds than higher rated AAA, AA and AAA national bonds. And you can see that in years 1 and 7. The lower interest rate that we were able to yield. And then once we got out to the 8 to 10 year period, we were getting the same interest rates as AAA rated bonds, which our bond rating folks were quite pleased with and sent us this chart. So I always do this every year because it's always a balancing act between, obviously, we're trying to maintain operational needs and the here and now, but it's also critically important that we also maintain reserves, not only for emergencies, but because it's critical to our financial strength and our bond rating, which affects the amount of money we have to spend on borrowing. Go to the next slide, please. So this is just a quick snapshot of our revenues, and we're looking at the current budget. This is the pie chart. This tells us where we derive most of our revenues from. The big blue, the 64.25%, is taxes. The next one is red, the 19.36%. That's coming from state revenues. And then the next largest one, the green one, is charges for services. That's just under 11%. That's everything from tuition that we charge at Smith-Volk. It's parking fees, ambulance fees, any of the other sort of fees that we charge. And then you get down into the smaller things like licenses, permits, et cetera. So that's kind of the pie chart of the FY 2016 budget. Next slide. We're going to look at just a few of the key revenues that affect the budget and that will affect our FY 17 budget. And these tend to be the ones that are cyclical and are affected by the economy at large. You can go to the next slide. New growth, that's that number that I highlighted earlier in the comparison charts. And the way new growth works is that under the Proposition 2.5 model, every year when we look at our tax base and we figure out, you know, how much we can expand that tax base, there's the 2.5% cap that you're allowed to sort of add into the base, and then you're also allowed to add in any new growth. That also gets added into the base because it's new buildings, it's new facilities. So that you're basically, what you're seeing there is the growth of the tax base. So that's why new growth is such an important number. We've had, you know, 2 to 3 years now of strong new growth. This year we were approaching $1 million, and so we're hopeful that that's going to be a trend that'll continue, particularly as we still have several major commercial projects as well as residential projects that are in construction. So that's a real strong indicator of our tax base. Next slide. This is just a quickie. This is uncollected taxes as a percentage of our net levy. And you can see that it's a very small amount. We're now under 1% in terms of uncollected taxes. And kudos to our finance director and her team that have been really working on this issue to make sure that any outstanding or uncollected or owner unknown properties or things like that, that we're able to address those and get them off our books. Next slide. This is motor vehicle excise. This is completely dependent on how many cars there are, you know, in Northampton. So if years that people may be buying more cars, that excise tax revenue goes up. And you can kind of see the trend. But that's a revenue that, again, is really dependent on the car buying economy. Next slide. This is hotel, motel, and meals tax. This is one, and there you'll notice that there was a bit of a jump. And actually, the meals tax is a new one, relatively new in 2010, because we, through a local option, were allowed to take 0.75% of the meals tax. That was a local option that we voted on. You can see that the meals tax has sort of been somewhat stable in the last four fiscal years. It's pretty much you know, right at the same level. You can see a slight uptick in the hotel motel tax, particularly last year in 2015. We did have a new hotel that opened last year that added many more rooms into the equation, so that may be part of it. But those, you know, as an economy that depends a lot on visitorship, hotel, motel, and meals tax are significant revenues for us. Next slide. Parking and ambulance charges. This is parking meter receipts and ambulance revenue. You can see the ambulance revenue kind of hit its peak in 2012, and now it's sort of tailed off a little bit. And then you can see the parking meter receipts. You know, where they are. And again, that sort of, there's not really trends for that per se. The next slide. This is another one that's dependent on the economy. This is all of the building permits and wiring fees. And, you know, you can see in 2014, which was also a big year for new growth, when we had a lot of the new facilities that were being built on King Street, the car dealerships, we had facilities being built up on Hospital Hill. We're continuing to see new construction projects coming online in 2016, and things like the Smith Library project will be another sort of big project that will also generate those kinds of fees. So again, that really depends on what the activity is out in the building and trades economy. Next slide. Fines. This is parking tickets and as well as RMV reimbursements, which is other kinds of motor vehicle fines. You know, I can see you, there's proof that we're giving out less parking tickets than we were last year. So those who complain that we're giving out parking tickets, you can see the numbers going down in terms of revenue. And again, that one you can see that there was an increase in 2011, 2012. That was a year that we raised we went from $10 to $15, so that's why there seems like there's a precipitous increase, but that was just the year we raised the ticket from $10 to a whopping $15. Next slide. Enterprise indirects. This is sort of a little bit complicated, but it's important to explain it. We have four enterprise funds. We have the water, sewer, solid waste, and stormwater. These are all separate utilities, separate budgets. All of the fees that are collected stay within that fund. They do, however, provide some money to the general fund through what we call indirects. And those are to reimburse the general fund for services that the general fund provides to the enterprise fund, including things like the health insurance that we provide for the employees, accounting, bookkeeping, lawyer, you know, all those kinds of things. And we did make a concerted effort in 2015 to really relook at all of our formulas for indirects and really make sure that those were trued up. The other major thing that happened is the Solid Waste Enterprise Fund has shrunk significantly, particularly after the landfill closed. You can kind of see that you know, 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, and now it's just a sort of a shadow of itself in 13, 14, 15, and 16. That's because the landfill closed. The red, the new enterprise fund, is the new stormwater enterprise fund that was added to that. But even with the addition of another fund, you can see that we are drawing less revenue from the enterprise funds to the general fund from indirects. Next slide. This is investment income. This is just showing, you know, how dismal most people's savings accounts and CDs and other have been over the last several years. We used to earn about $600,000 of interest back in 2007. You know, now 10 years later, it's under $100,000 with all the money that we have in short term. Next slide. Okay, now we get into the fun and sometimes aggravating stuff. This is state aid. This is net state aid from over the last 10 years. And this is basically what we netted out after state charges. And you can see, and this is sort of based right off the cherry sheets for those years, you can see where we were in 2016, and you can kind of show the arc over time. You know, from a high in FY 2008 of almost over $12 million in aid, now in 2016 we're at, you know, 9.7 million, and you can see it really hasn't it didn't really increase much from 2015, and as we see later, it's not really going to increase, at least the way we're looking at it right now, in 2017. But that sort of shows you what the arc of state aid is. So, you know, when I hear people say we're increasing state aid this year, it's like, yes, you are, but we're still not even where we were 10 years ago. And you can see in FY 2006, we were receiving in real dollars more state aid in 2006 than we're receiving in the current budget year, 2016. Next slide. So this is unrestricted local aid, UGA. It's unrestricted governmental aid. This is the line item that you may have heard in the recent announcement of the governor's budget yesterday, that they are increasing, and they've made an effort to actually tie it to the growth of revenues, which is 4.3%, which is good. So this year, they are projecting an increase of 4.2%, or a little over $174,000. So you can see that account is going to increase. Again, that's about a $4 million aid line item. I also have to point out, again, same thing, if you look where we were 10 years ago, we're still receiving less today than we were receiving 10 years ago in that account. So that's the unrestricted local governmental aid line item. Next slide. Now we get into Chapter 70, which is, as you can see, is a much larger, it's $7 million. This is the principal aid that comes to all cities and towns to fund education. It's based on a formula, it's based on a state foundation budget, and which we'll talk about a little bit later. This is one that wasn't really highlighted much in the governor's budget release, except to say that there was gonna be more money put into the program. The difficulty is Northampton, like a majority of cities and towns, is a minimum aid community. And so basically the governor is proposing to put an increase in this, you know, $7 million line item to Northampton of $56,900, which is 0.7% increase. And basically it's $20 per child. They're basically using the same formula that the governor used last year, $20 per child increase. Last year the legislature raised it to $25 per child, but we still got a minimum aid allocation. But this is particularly concerning, and you can sort of see just the flat line that has occurred over the last, 5 years in the Chapter 70 budget at a time when the costs in education have been going on a much different plan. Let's go to the next slide. Was the Chapter 71 in there? Or that's coming later, right? Okay, great. Okay, so this is the expenditures. This basically shows you the breakdown of what we spend our dollars on in the current fiscal year. And the pie chart is kind of broken out. Education, 38.76. Employee benefits is 19%. Public safety, a little under 15%. Debt service, 6.3%. And then it goes down into the smaller areas of general government, public works, et cetera. Let's go to the next slide. This shows you kind of a 5 or 6 year, what were the spending categories. So it's 11 through 16. By category, the lowest one is education. Just in sort of order, education, the next was employee benefits, public safety, debt service, general government, and then down into the smaller departments. So that just kind of shows you over that 5 year span, what our funds have been spent on. Next slide. I always add this slide because even though the first slide showed education as 38.76%, because we also provide indirect costs from the general fund to the education side, to the school departments, it doesn't include health benefits, it doesn't include retirement, it doesn't include insurance, it doesn't include debt service and other services. So when you actually add those things in, the total cost of education on that dollar that we're spending is about 54%. So 54% of our tax dollars is going toward education. Next slide. This shows you the appropriation. This is the appropriation budget that, I have to point out, it's both Smith Vocational and the Northampton Public Schools. Northampton's the one in red, and Smith Voc is the one in orange. This kind of shows you historically the arc of the appropriation budget. You can see that there was a slightly bigger increase from 13 to 14. That was the year that we passed the override. And then, in 15 and 16, we've been trying to give increases, again, based on the override and the fiscal stability plan that I'll talk about a little bit later. But that sort of shows you the arc of the appropriation budget. I can't do it magically now, but if you superimpose that arc and you superimpose the Chapter 70 arc, you can see who's picking up the slack in terms of the costs of education. Next slide. This is a net outgoing charter and choice slide. This is basically looking at charter school outgoing and school choice outgoing tuition, net of the state charter reimbursement. And so it just kind of focuses on those two outgoing line items, which is about 2.7 million that goes out the door. And again, you can see the rapid rise of those as expenditures over the last 10 years, how that's become a much bigger part of our budget. You can go to the next slide. This is a little bit, number intense, but I did want to kind of walk you through it just to kind of show you how the math works, because people always ask, okay, what about charter? What about choice? So just to walk you from the top to the bottom, 203 students in FY 2016 went to charter schools. That tuition was cost $2.477 million. Then there was the reimbursement. That's the $212,940 and the $180. So that means that minus reimbursement, we're spending a little over $2 million in charter school going out the door in charter school tuition. Then we have the choice that are leaving. 85 are heading out, and we're sending $572,388 in tuition going out. Next week, so that totals to 288 students at 2.5 million. Then you also have to offset the incoming. We're getting 219 kids coming in, which yields us $1.7 million in incoming school choice tuition. But at the bottom of the screen, at the end of the day, the net, we basically have 69 less students, and we have almost $1 million less in funding at the end of the calculation. So that just sort of walks you through the whole charter choice calculation. Next slide. The other thing, the reason why those numbers sometimes don't make sense when you look at them that way, is that the per student cost is different. So the average outgoing tuition, if you're a charter student, is $12,000. The average tuition, if you're a choice student, just going from one public school district to another public school district, is about $7,800. And then the incoming average is about $6,700. That's part of the reason why even the large amount of choice students that we receive is not enough to make up for the substantial difference in the cost of the charter school tuition. Next slide. This is actually, I just put it up here. I don't expect you to be able to see it, but this is literally a snapshot from the DESE website. And they actually have this information up there by year. And there's a yellow number highlighted out at the far right-hand side. And that basically says state aid at full funding. So that is the statutory, that's what Northampton was supposed to receive statutorily in FY15 under the state law. That's assuming that the legislature and governor appropriate the full amount of money, which they never do. So in that particular year, we received actually $251,510 less than we should have received, because the legislature and governor typically don't fully fund charter school reimbursement. You can also see that in FY2016, the current budget year, we were again shorted a little under $200,000. And again, it's right there on their website. It says what the full state aid at full funding is supposed to be, and then it says what the total actual charter aid was. And so that sort of illustrates for you. Do we have that number on this slide? Just by way of comparison, the cherry sheet that just came out last night, this is the governor's FY17 budget. He's said that they're putting more money into charter school reimbursement. He's also made some changes to the formula and the way that it's going to be spread out. We haven't seen that yet, but under the governor's proposal, we are slated to receive $330,848 in charter school reimbursement. So actually, even less than we're receiving in this fiscal year. The charter school funding formula continues to be a major issue for us. And I want to give a public shout out to our state senator and the Senate president, because in this debate about whether we should raise the cap on charters or not, he's been very clear that it shouldn't just be a question of do we raise the cap or not raise the cap. He really wants to open up the entire program and the funding structure and the history of the program, and look at the demographics, and he really wants to take a holistic look at the whole program. And this whole reimbursement issue is really key, and those other disparities that I showed you earlier between the tuitions for a charter school student versus a public school student who's choosing is another major issue as well. So hopefully there may be some changes on the horizon, but the charter school issue continues to be a major fiscal challenge for us. The only other thing I'll close with on that is that go to the next slide, there is also this other issue in the education funding world, which is about the foundation budget. There was actually a report commissioned at the end of last year, the Foundation Budget Review Commission, which was actually tasked with looking at that Chapter 70 foundation number, which was established back in 1993. And that report basically concluded what everybody's known and what any superintendent can tell you, and which many did when they testified, including Dr. Provost and myself and school committee members, that basically the formula that was created back in 1993 really hasn't accounted for rapid increases in things like health insurance, special education, English language learner, low-income students are really not reflected in that model. And by conservative estimates, the Chapter 70 program is probably about $1 billion underfunded in terms of what the true costs of educating students are. So the other sort of takeaway about that Chapter 70 number that I showed you for Northampton and the governor's budget is that he does not in any way address any of the recommendations of this review commission, which is it's a very short report. It's not rocket science, and it's a 14-page report, and they basically are very clear that you need to change this, you need to change that, you need to add more money, but his budget doesn't reflect that. Again, my hope will be that hopefully the legislature may take a look at that when it looks at Chapter 70 and decides how it's going to fund education aid. Next slide. This is employee benefits. Principally, it's health insurance. This has been one of the major budget drivers. I just referenced it under the Chapter 70 discussion. It's been one of our biggest cost drivers. You can see the costs, how they've risen over time. We're just at or a little bit over $10 million. We have worked really hard to control costs in healthcare. You may remember back in FY13, we joined the Group Insurance Commission, the state's health insurance program. You can see that has helped keep our costs down over the last 5 years with average increases of about 1.4%, which has been really good compared to the wider world. We don't have our health insurance number yet for the upcoming fiscal year. The GIC will be meeting and voting on that and releasing that information in March. We have been hearing that many of the insurance companies, at least in their initial submissions to the GIC, have been coming in with some increases. But we're hopeful that the buying power of the state and the negotiating power of the state, that they'll be able to keep those minimal, because that is a major cost driver for us. Every one percentage point in our health insurance is $100,000 that we have to spend in our budget. So the difference between a 2% and a 5% could be significant. That's $300,000 more that we'd have to come up with for that line item. So that's going to be one of the key numbers that we're going to be looking at over the next couple of months as we finish the budget. Next slide. This is our retirement assessment. This comes from the City of Northampton Retirement System. It's a separate private system that uses actuarial tables and looks at the market and the rate of return. And so we do have to make adjustments incrementally over time in terms of the assessment that we have to pay in. This year, we're looking at almost a 4% increase for FY17, but you can see the costs that have been going up over time. Okay, next slide, please. This is just a quick run through some of the key budgetary areas. Again, just showing you that 10-year comparison. This is public safety. It just kind of shows the growth of the budget in public safety over 10 years. You can go to the next slide. We're going to go through these pretty quickly. This is debt service. This just shows both our long-term, our short-term, as well as our temporary bonds. This is what we're paying every year in order to basically pay our debt, to pay the things that we've borrowed on these large projects, including school buildings, roads, equipment, et cetera. So this is what we're spending on debt service every year. Next slide. This is general government. Again, just sort of everything other than schools and public safety. Next slide. Public works. The only thing I'll point out on this one is it looks like there was a dip over the last 2 years in public works. That's actually because that is only the general fund public works. It doesn't include any of the enterprise funds. And we actually, one of the reasons we created this, the stormwater and flood control, is because we were trying to pay for it out of the general fund. So we moved those off into an enterprise fund. So you see that there's a slight reduction in the budget the last 2 years, but there's an enterprise fund that's now funding some of those things that were in the general fund budget. Next slide. This is culture and recreation. This is the libraries. This is parks and rec. This is arts and culture. And it's our first night celebration that we fund as well. Next slide. This is human service spending. This is veterans. This is senior services. This is health department. You'll obviously notice the big spike in veteran services that occurred at the beginning of the 2000s. That was largely because of the number of returning veterans who were coming home and coming to the VA hospital, coming to Northampton. And so we really had to increase our expenditures. That has sort of leveled off a little bit now in terms of the caseload for our veterans, but that explains why that one has risen so rapidly over time. And kudos to our Veterans Service Office and to the regional Veterans District that we lead for, you know, providing really great services to the men and women who serve our country and have come back to Northampton. Next slide. Okay, now we'll switch gears and we'll talk a little bit about the fiscal stability plan, which has really guided our work over the last several years. And you may remember that when we put forth the override proposal back in June of 2013, what I asked the voters or told the voters was that we were going to request a $2.5 million override, operating override. We needed it to close about a $1.2 million gap that year going into FY14. But the plan was that we wouldn't spend that entire $2.5 million. We would actually put it in a fiscal stability fund that would be separate. It would be, you know, tracked. People could see it. And we would not use that money right away. We would actually, in some cases, we would add to it for a couple of fiscal years. This was the original plan that we put forward back in FY2014. And it showed us basically 2014, we used some of the funds to basically stabilize the budget, to stave off cuts in the schools and in public safety and in general government. Then in 2015, you can see that we would start to again put more money into the fiscal stability fund, and then in 2016, which is the current budget we are in, we would again begin doing, you know, having money in that fiscal stability plan. We show you the fund, what that's at. In 2017, we would actually, the year we were going into, we would actually have to draw from that fund in order to basically keep our services and maintain level services. And then by 2018, we would be back facing a deficit. That's sort of the, that's sort of what we were, thought we were facing back in FY 2014. That was the original stability plan. What we also said is that basically every year we're gonna revisit that plan. We're also gonna work really hard to increase revenue, to try to keep spending down, to be really smart and looking at ways we could save money, we could, you know, consolidate departments, whatever it could be to keep our expenses down so that we could stretch it out and make it last. And that every year since, we've basically looked at that plan, looked at all of the assumptions and updated them year by year to see if we could stretch them out. So currently, as we now begin that exercise again during this budget, we can go to the next slide. And I'm saying preliminary because it's preliminary, because we, again, we don't have all of our final budget numbers, we don't have our state aid, we don't have that health insurance number. You know, we're basically looking at, you know, in 2017, you know, we're moving along, we've got the fiscal stabilization fund that's there. In 2018, blue, we need to potentially tap into the fiscal stability fund in order, again, to maintain level services. In 19, we'd need to start drawing a little bit more from that fund. In 20, we'd start to see some financial pressure. And then in 2021, we basically would be back facing a deficit and the fiscal stability fund would be depleted. And so, and as I said, and let's, can we go back to the previous slide? I don't know, is that hard to do? Well, actually, just leave, it's okay. Just leave that slide right. Sorry, fine. So, I mean, what I said, and I'll say it again, what I said back in 2013 is that, you know, this is going to buy us these 5 years, but if we are unable to see, you know, increased revenue, if we're unable, if, you know, for example, if the state doesn't come through with more revenue or more favorable formulas, that we're basically going to be back in 2018 telling the voters that if we're gonna have to do another fiscal stability plan, we're gonna have to ask them for another override in order to build another multi-year plan. And I don't wanna do that. I'd like to not have to do that. Going ahead to the next slide, you can see we have been able to push that off. I mean, we were basically under the original plan, you know, this would be the last year, and next year we'd be basically facing the cliff again. We've been able to now push that off, and you see it's out at 2021, but it's still pretty close. And it's a little bit difficult, particularly when you look at the numbers we're getting, at least in the initial budget from the state, that we're really not seeing much of an increase in any of our state aid category. We're seeing some increases, but you'll see later when you net it out, it's really not an increase. So again, this gets back to the issue of more pressure being put on the local property tax base, which is capped, and more pressure at the local level because there's not a willingness to try to raise new revenues at the state level. And you know, there's this debate going on, and again, I got to give kudos to Senate President and our state representative. You know, the governor says we have a you know, expenditure problem, and the Senate President disagrees and thinks we have a revenue problem. So that's sort of the big debate that's happening in Beacon Hill. Doesn't look like it's going to go anywhere. So we're left with trying to fend for ourselves here at home. And so this is what we're looking at, again, preliminarily. Once I finalize the budget numbers, once we have the health care numbers, once we have a better sense of what the state budget's going to look like, and when I submit my budget to the city council, we'll have a sort of an updated stability plan based on those numbers. But that's what it's looking like sitting here tonight. If you can go to the next slide. So when we look internally at our budget, and when we look at our revenues for FY17, we kind of have a good sense. I mean, we know what our 2.5 increases, we know what our new growth estimates are, we know what some of the other revenue increases. We're projecting that our local revenue is going to increase about 2%, or $1.7 million. Then you go down to the state aid number, and you see, yeah, we're going to get a 4.3 boost in unrestricted, we're going to get 0.7 in Chapter 70, charter schools down. But if you actually go through the cherry sheet that they just sent us last night, the cherry sheet is basically the sheet, and as it's on the DOR website, every community gets one. It basically shows you not only all of the state revenues that you're going to get through these various programs, it also shows you all the charges that you'll be charged by the state for various things, including for things like, you know, PVTA assessment. There's a number of different charges that you get charged, and so at the end of the day, when we basically added up the cherry sheet and we added up what they're projecting in revenue, what they're projecting in charges, we're actually going to receive about $3,000 less than we received last year from the state. Again, based on the governor's budget, not there's still a House budget and there's a Senate budget. So that kind of gives you sort of the lay of the land in terms of what we know today based on, again, the governor's budget, which is just a starting point. Let's go to the next slide. So in terms of expenditure issues, again, what we know, and I mentioned earlier, we've got some assessments that are, you know, you can sort of add them up a little bit. You know, the retirement assessment, which we know, that's almost 200,000. The PVTA assessment, which is going up, in increases in workers' comp, insurance. I mean, just right there, that's about 300,000 of the 1.7 million that we know we have to pay for, which leaves us about 1.4 million. What we don't know, of course, are health insurance, collective bargaining. All of our collective bargaining units, both on the city and the school side, are in the final year of their three-year contract, so we'll be in collective bargaining this year, trying to negotiate new contracts. And obviously, those numbers that get bargained will have to be factored into our budget. And then obviously all the final state revenues and charges that I've talked about. But, you know, in terms of room to maneuver, you know, it's a big overall budget of, you know, 100 plus million. But in terms of how much maneuverability and new money we have to spend at this point, you know, it's that $1.7 million for the city and the schools. And again, it's about a 2% growth factor over last year's budget. And again, the budget I submitted to you and was passed last year in FY16, the overall budget grew by 1.98%. So you know, we've been, again, trying to keep that growth down so we can extend that fiscal stability plan, but we're, you know, these are the pressures we're up against when things like health insurance may go up at a higher rate, labor costs may go up at a higher rate, and then all the other expenses that may go up as well. So that's kind of the perennial pressure point that we're facing. Next slide. This is quickly just the budget process timeline. This shows you sort of some of it set by charter. Tonight I'm doing this joint meeting. February, I'll be submitting the water and sewer rates to the city council. That will help us determine what next year's water and sewer rates will be, which will then in turn help us determine what our budget is for the water and sewer enterprise funds. On March 3rd, I'm required to submit a five-year capital improvement program, which just outlines all the capital projects that we anticipate over the next 5 years. By April 17th, both of the two school districts have to have adopted their budgets and submitted them to me. Then 1 month later, on May 17th, I am required to present a FY 2017 budget to the city council. And then there's some public hearing requirements. The city council has to hold a hearing by the end of May on the capital program, and then has to hold a hearing and adopt, hopefully, our FY 2017 budget. So there's a lot of stuff that'll be happening between now and then. Obviously, I'll be meeting with our departments. I'll be meeting with the superintendents of both school districts. I'll be meeting with the libraries to talk about their individual budgets. We'll also be obviously watching Beacon Hill very closely to see what the House of Representatives and the Ways and Means Committee in particular submits, and then obviously how the Senate responds to that. But that's kind of the timeline that we'll be following over the next several months as we put together the city budget. Next slide, which I think just is the end, and it's Q&A. So if you wanted to, just turn on the lights. And again, I'll just answer any questions, or try to. Councilor Adams.
Did you state that it was impossible for the city to have a triple A plus rating?
Yeah, we've looked into that, and I don't know that it's impossible, but we haven't found any other similar sized cities with that rating. So I need to do a little bit more research on that, because part of its size and scale and the amount of money, but I'm not aware of any others, but I can do more research and get you more information on that. Yes.
Thank you. And with respect to the retirement, thinking about the retirement assessment, do you plan on putting money into the PEB and OPEB trust again?
Yeah, that's in our budget. Yeah, we do. The OPEB is the other than post-employment employee benefits. That's a new accounting method that we're supposed to show. And we did begin an OPEB trust fund, and we are projected to put more money into that fund this year. We're actually the governor has put forward a series of reform that's going to look at the OPEB trust fund structure and ways that cities can start those. So that may also be something we'll be looking at if that passes. But we are starting to put money in an OPEB trust fund. Other questions?
I saw that the governor was going to increase spending for vocational schools by about $83 million in the proposal. Mm-hmm. Will Smith Volk see any of that?
You know, I know that they're going to be making some investments in spending. I haven't actually seen that it's been put into whether it's going to be grants to schools or whether it's going to be in Chapter 74 funding. I don't know what it is. I mean, in terms of our school district, we actually, because Smith is a local district of Northampton, we get Chapter 78 for our students. Other communities pay tuition, so 75, I think it's 75 to $83 million. I know that they're trying to increase different vocational programs. They're trying to do a lot of workforce partnerships and things like that. So I don't quite know whether that's for those kinds of activities or whether it's actually going to be an infusion of funds into their budgets. I do know that we are looking at our obligation to Smith Volk, and I know that one of the things that came up on the cherry sheet is our net school spending requirement is going up this year in terms of what we have to allocate to Smith Volk. So that will be another area that we're looking at in terms of increased funding. But I don't know how those grants are going to play out.
Okay. I don't know if you know this. You gave two numbers. 38.76% of the budget is education, but really 54.3. Mm-hmm. How does that compare with other area towns? Do you know that?
You know, I think I can refer to Dr. Provost and Ms. Walczak, but I mean, most communities are spending 50% to 60% on education. I don't know, I'll let you weigh in, Dr. Provost. And
I would agree that similar communities have similar costs. The only exception would be communities that have much higher Chapter 70 funding. Mm-hmm. And in that case, the state is bearing a greater portion of their education costs.
Like Holyoke, for example.
Right.
Much larger percentage is coming in direct Chapter 78 and less from the tax base.
Early on in your slides, when you showed the outgoing costs up against the incoming revenue that came in, I'm assuming that those incoming numbers included the numbers coming in for Smith Volk from all of the accounts. Is that correct?
No. Okay. That's only choice. It's not tuition to Smith Volk.
Okay. Yeah, so that's a separate.
Yeah, that's completely separate. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's a the tuition is set by the school, and that's a separate revenue stream that comes in under those fees and charges.
Is that something that we'll see in a page that will appear in a budget that's
well, actually, you do appropriate that tuition over to, we receive that, we actually, as part of our appropriation to Smith Volk, we appropriate the projected tuition as well as the city's contribution as well, so that's in there, and usually contained in their budget narrative, which is in the overall city budget. They will talk about, what their enrollment looks like, and per pupil and the tuition. I don't believe we've set the tuition yet for the upcoming school year. That usually happens sometime in the spring, and so part of their calculation when they build their budget is not only looking at some of these aid categories, but they're also trying to project, how many new students will we have, how many students will come in. Because Northampton students represent a small portion, 20% of their student body. So that's their own unique challenge when they build their budget.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Klein.
I came in late and I apologize for that. I couldn't get away from work on time, but I wanted to ask, just in case, I may have missed it because I came in late.
Yeah.
But I wanted to ask about savings because of renewables that the city has pursued and installed. Did you have a slide about that before I got
here? We don't have a slide about that. We do actually, though, have a fund in which we, it's an energy and sustainability fund in which we do deposit any of our, like, SREX credits that we get from our solar arrays. And actually we use that to reinvest in projects that are, again, promoting alternative energy or energy conservation. Most of the savings, I don't think we projected energy. We don't have an energy cost slide. That's something we could add for a future presentation. But we have made significant efforts through conservation and through mechanical installations at all of our facilities, and switching over to natural gas, which maybe in retrospect I'm not sure about, but in some cases natural gas, and so we've been able to realize savings that way. But it's not like we get a check for it. It's been savings that less money that we've had to spend, and actually it's actually helped us fund those energy improvements.
I just think it would be nice to have a kind of side by side of what we've actually saved, what we've been able to invest. Pursuing, I think that it just shows the conscientiousness.
No, definitely.
We're pursuing that.
No, that's a good suggestion. So we can look at that. We can try to highlight that in the actual budget a little bit. So, yep. Councilor.
First, I'll say that the news that we can hopefully extend the fiscal stability plan by 2+ years is very welcome and worthy of note and recognition for that hard work. Now, my question, which is totally separate, it's $12,000 for a charter student when they leave, and for a student who choices out, it's about $8,000. How much is it per student who stays?
Yeah, that was on the slide. The per pupil costs were like $13,000, I think, in 14. That's the latest numbers that are on the DESE website. I think it's $13,000 or so is what it costs us, what we're spending per pupil on a child in Northampton. And the tuition's a blended rate because every charter school has a different tuition, so it's sort of the average because they get assigned a different tuition rate. The other thing I'll tell you, which is The other sort of frustrating thing about the charter formula is, you know, they're not using that Chapter 70 kind of foundation budget formula to come up with the cost of educating the charter student. They're looking at that, but then they also add an additional, what is it called, above foundation aid. They have an above foundation aid number, which is basically based on what we're spending above foundation aid. That also gets added in. And this was something, it was a little off topic, but it was something I testified before the Foundation Review Committee. You know, the irony is, so we get cuts, you know, $2 million, we lose $2 million in charter school funding. You know, we pass a $2.5 million override. Well, a portion of that override gets calculated into the tuition, the outgoing tuition. So we actually end up sending some of that override money away with the tuition to the charter school. Because again, it's counted as above foundation spending. So it's again one of the other sort of inequities, I think, to the system, because the idea is, you know, people here have made an investment in our public school system. They voted to raise their taxes to do this. They didn't vote to raise their taxes to send more money to another, you know, outside school. So that's really a frustrating aspect of the way the system currently works.
Are there any voluntary pilot payments anticipated and reflected here? And
they're not reflected in the budget. As you know, I did announce and do a series of public meetings around pilot, and we will be communicating with our largest private nonprofits in the coming months about that pilot request. But what I've said, and I said it during the presentation, we're not really budgeting that as revenue because it's a voluntary gift, and so we it's actually not really something we'd be allowed to, you know, build a budget on and then go to DOR and said, you know, this is a voluntary request we're making, and so we're going to count that in. And also, we wouldn't want to book it in, and then if it doesn't come in, then we have a shortfall. So what I basically said around the pilot is, if and when we do receive pilot payments, because of the way it's going to come in as an additional revenue that wasn't budgeted for, we're probably going to use that, put that into things like the capital program, which is going to then free up revenue that we'd be spending from the general fund budget for capital to give us, you know, more flexibility in the operational spending on schools and on public safety and on everything else. So it's going to be infused into the budget, but we really can't budget for it. You know, unless, you know, in some cases we do have some like signed multi-year pilot arrangements where we can actually predict some revenue. That's a different story. But in something like this that's completely voluntary, we really can't budget for it. But I am going to pursue it, and that's, you know, one of the reasons, you know, this presentation and looking at our revenue growth, that's one of the reasons why I've pursued this pilot program, again, trying to find new sources of local revenue other than property taxes, or increasing property taxes on taxpayers. Yes, Ms. Berman.
Could you touch upon, when I was reading about Baker's budget, and when I've done research about the charter school funding, which is a bit convoluted, there is this discussion of the funding of year one, yeah, less funding year two, to nothing,
yeah,
year three. Would you touch upon how that affects the budgets that we're dealing with?
I may ask Dr. Provost a little bit, because he's a bit more of an expert, but it's been a five-year program, although they've never actually funded it in 5 years, and it had been a five-year glide path but I'll defer to Dr. Provost, who knows this much better.
Thank you. So the five-year plan, which is the current plan, although my understanding is that part of the governor's budget proposal was to change from a five-year plan to a three-year plan, basically is a 100, 25, 25, 25, 25 plan, which means that you would receive 100% of the net change in tuition if you were increasing the number of students going to a charter school. It's a per school change, not a per district change, in the first year. And then in each of the four subsequent years, you would receive 25% of the change. So the formula would really be looking at 5 years worth of net changes between each of the different schools that the district is sending students to. The tricky part is that the legislation says that it's subject to appropriations. And so, as the mayor said, historically the legislature has never fully funded the amount. So when that happens, they try to first put money into the first year and then drop off the follow-along years. I think last year for Northampton, our first year 100% figure was really 58%, and then it was 0% for the outgoing years. So I don't know what the details of the governor's new three-year plan are, or how that could affect us. That's something I'll certainly be studying as details come out.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Baird.
So Smith Folk essentially operates as its own school district.
They are a school district. They are a local school district of the city of Northampton, and they have a separate Board of Trustees, which actually myself and Dr. Provo serve on the acts as a school committee. And they develop a budget which is voted on as part of the larger city budget by the city council that I submit to them. So it's analogous to the Northampton School Department. The difference, of course, is their funding is a little bit different, because about 23% of the student body is Northampton, and the larger remaining amount is from other sending districts. And there's a tuition. The state actually establishes kind of a maximum tuition, and then the trustees have to vote on what the actual tuition is. And there's some real challenges happening now in Voc Ed around the regulations and the way they're funded. And that's one of the reasons why there's been the Department of Education has done a major kind of governance and financial study of Smith Voc. It's actually on our website. And have really been looking, because Smith is one of a kind in the state. We're the only community in Massachusetts that has two local school districts. No other community has that. And they're sort of not quite a local district. I mean, they treat them as a local district, but they kind of look like a regional district because of the makeup of the student body, but they're not a regional district either. I mean, it's funny, when we were at the MMA conference, they handed out these sheets about this is what your aid's going to be, and they had, you know, the Northampton schools under local districts, and they put Smith Voc under regional districts, because it's like, where else do you put them? Because they're sort of a category of one. So they have some unique challenges, including where their students will come from, because there's a lot of pressure right now from other districts that are feeling much like the charter school tension of having to send kids out of district to a vocational school. And a lot of districts, it's become somewhat competitive. We've been reading about the town of Amherst, who's going to try to start offering their own vocational programs, and that's in part a way to try to keep kids in district. So there's a lot of stuff happening in the Voc world, and some fluctuation. And so we're trying to get ahead of the curve. And there's been some conversation, and the Department of Education is really interested in it, because west of 495, we're really it in terms of especially agricultural education. So they have an interest in making sure that Smith Voc remains strong. So we're trying to figure out what's the model, for the next 100 years that'll keep it viable.
So follow-up question. So is there any benefit or any reason, or is it a possibility for Smith Voc to essentially become like a seventh school to public schools? And
I got into trouble for suggesting that. There's an editorial about that a long time ago. Since declared peace on that. That was one of the things that they looked at. The challenge there is that DESE basically hired the Donahue Institute at UMass, and they did a fairly comprehensive study that really drills down into the numbers and looks at the demographics, and they did look at that model, which is a model where, you know, they would just become like Westfield has its own school. The problem is you'd still have the financial issues, and in fact it might actually be exacerbated, because you'd be going from the tuition, to school choice, to, you know, that, so we're not quite sure how it would work. But they really thought that while you could see some savings, that the model probably wouldn't work in terms of the long-term viability of serving that regional population that they serve. So what's really being looked at is sort of, can they come up with kind of a hybrid, regional, quasi-regional hybrid, or more larger regional district. Something similar occurred in the eastern part of the state. There was an agriculture school in Essex County. There were two. One was owned by the county, and they really were in danger of losing both schools, and they ended up, the state stepped in and helped, actually came up with a funding model, helped build a new, it's actually brand new, Essex Agricultural and Technical School, that's sort of a mega regional school out in that area. And so they're kind of looking at models like that for Smith Folk. Yeah. Councilor O'Donnell.
I like to see if we can make the conversation gloomier. It's not gloomy enough to my sense.
Yeah.
So as you project out and you've extended the fiscal stability plan a couple of years, and you've done it not just this year, but last year you did it too.
Yeah.
And that's owing to the work of your office and innovations you've made. But it's also due to, I imagine, just circumstances being favorable. I'm wondering, what's the, and I say that not that, that everything's great, because again, I'm trying to make this gloomy.
No, but things like the new growth. I mean, that's
right.
You know,
we're so that's
a strong local economy. The fact that we're at the head of that chart,
yes,
that's not insignificant.
Well, that's my question. So what's the flexibility built in when you look out into the future? I mean, arguably, we could be facing a bigger deficit in FY19 if things don't hold. Mm-hmm. You know, and so I mean, what is your thinking in terms of how the fiscal stability plan might vary? Would you ever feel pressure to use some of our other stability funds, for example? Or would you hold those sacrosanct?
Well, you know, again, I think we'd have to, you know, the problem with using, anytime you use your reserve funds in the operating budget, is that you plug a hole, but then you're standing in a deeper hole the next year because it's one-time money. It's not recurring revenue. So, you know, the fiscal stability fund was a very specified amount of money. You know, we raised it through this override. We've actually been adding to it. We're not drawing from it. We've been adding to it. Again, that's part of why we've been able to extend it. And you know, we draw from it. And yeah, that would be a question we'd have to face.
Not something I'm suggesting.
But the problem becomes then, you know, if you go ahead and like really, really start to fund one-time expenses using one-time money, then you start meeting with your bond rating agencies and you start downgrading your bond, and then you're starting to borrow at 3%, 4%, or 5% again, and then your general fund debt service amount is going up. So it becomes very difficult.
Yeah, I guess that was more of a digression about the other funds. But I mean, how confident are you that, you know, FY20 is kind of the year that we'd be looking at in terms of the end of the fiscal stability?
I'm an optimist. I tend to be an optimist, and so I'm going to do everything I can. I mean, we did things in this budget year, which I'll be talking about when I do the FY17 budget. I mean, we've been making changes. We've continued to affect consolidations in departments, and we're trying to do things in technology to affect savings. So we're going to do everything we can do to extend it. And I'm, you know, hopefully we're not going to be in that position. I hope that the legislature takes a look at a study which was a commission that was chaired by members of the legislature and made up of people in the legislature who know this problem. I'm hoping they're going to address that issue. I'm not going to wait for casino revenues to start pouring in, because we've seen that's been the dead end that we all thought it would be. And I'll continue to be aggressive on the pilot stuff. But I can't really tell you what we would be facing in FY19. I may not even be the mayor in FY19. But I'm going to certainly do everything I can between now and then to push that out, to avoid the override.
And just finally, as a coda to this, it just amazes me because I imagine many other communities are not even close to where Northampton is in terms of the fiscal stability plan that you've put forward, which I think is exceptional. And so I just can't understand if we have almost every other city and town in the Commonwealth facing the same kind of pressures. I mean, it's not like there's a lot of flexibility in the budget. In the
no.
It's very much like, you know, and so other cities and towns have to be facing the same thing. It just seems inconceivable that you wouldn't have a change from the legislature to help.
Well, that is the frustrating thing, and it's particularly frustrating when I hear the Speaker of the House say, you know, middle-class families are hurting, so we can't raise revenues at the state level. Well, they're hurting because their property taxes are forcing them out of their homes
yeah,
because
right.
they can't afford to live in their communities anymore, and their kids, you know, are suffering, and you know, school systems are suffering. I mean, that's really where that's hitting people. It's not, you know, because we're paying a 5% income tax, which is, you know, one of the lowest on the lower end of the scale. You know, there is the ballot initiative, which, you know, thank you to all the Northampton residents who helped put that on the ballot and get the signatures, which would enact a 4% tax increase for income over $1 million that would be dedicated to schools and to transportation. I say that's great news, and then the education secretary, Dr. Pizer, said he's not in favor of it, which I cannot even understand how that happens. But yeah, so but that's one area that we could see new revenue that clearly wouldn't hurt middle class families or low income families. So I'm hoping there'll be some support for that because that's revenue that would help this situation that we're facing. Sorry, Mr. Meyer. Oh,
I just have a question about the political picture that the governor is trying to paint, and also the response from, for instance, Mass Municipal Association. Because by all accounts, he was warmly received. I understand he's a guest, and you're nice to your guests. But you know, he was received an ovation for the 4.3% increase in an account that's $1 billion. But I didn't hear about the reaction to the 1.6% increase in the $4.58 billion account.
Yeah.
And again, as you've just recounted, if most municipal leaders are looking at budgets that are 50% plus, and in some towns much more, some small towns much more, for education, you know, what is sort of pushback is going to go on as this proceeds to the House and then the Senate to make sure that, you know, the so-called historic levels of education funding are actually called out for what they are.
Exactly.
Which is, you know, it's hard for me to see how the taxpayers of Northampton, assuming that our contribution to the 4.3% increase in tax revenues is approximately the same share, that we are receiving such a small share, because we're not even up to the 1.6%, as you pointed out in your slides, we're at the 0.7%. Mm-hmm. And again, it's 0.7% of more than half the pie.
Yeah.
It just insults the intelligence, but again, I'm just wondering when does that pushback start?
Well, you know,
people say that Chapter 70. I mean, unrestricted government aid is very important, but again, looking at your slides, the general government portion is not near what we spend on education. And again, that's because it's a priority. That's why Massachusetts schools are the best in the country, and some of the best in the world, because we do fund them.
Yeah. Well, you know. Yes, there was a warm reception, and there's always a warm reception for any governor that comes to that conference. And but I will say, and you can go to the MMA website, they have put out a very detailed set of talking points about the budget, which highlights all these issues that I've been talking about tonight. And I haven't even mentioned things like circuit breaker, you know, for special ed being level funded, you know, the district you work in, regional transportation level funded, which is a killer for rural districts, and a lot of other areas that are level funded. So, you know, MMA will shift now and start to focus on the House and Senate, like they always do. And so, you know, that's what they'll be doing. And I was and quoted today, along with the mayor of East Hampton, you know, speaking out about, you know, my concerns about it, and I'm sure other municipal leaders will as well, because, you know, we're all facing the same situation. So that's all I can really tell you about that. Council President.
First, thank you for the comprehensive and, more importantly, comprehensible presentation. What is incomprehensible is pretty much what Downing refers to. This enormous political disconnect with the citizens, for the most part. You also often hear the citizenry advocating for reduced income taxes, thinking that that is the sole taxation point. It's a progressive tax system. We are suffering the consequences of a continued and expanding reliance on regressivity as far as taxation. It punishes all, first of all, subsidizing schools based on valuation on property as a built-in disparity. It doesn't create equity across the board. It creates, and then you add to the mix this supposedly competitive program of charter schools, which is supposed to improve the quality of the schools. Well, that's the way it was sold, of course, that competing systems would, just like in the free marketplace, creates dynamism. And we're finding the opposite impact. So we lose on revenue, we lose on the inspiration that was supposed to occur, and we have this conversation every year without it ever improving. In fact, actually, it's a death of a thousand cuts. We experience this kind of lament with the pressures increasing more on property taxes, which as you said, was your inspiration for going out and asking for a payment in lieu of taxes from other agencies, the same way we ask citizens for overrides, asking people to participate in helping us bail out this boat that the state keeps throwing rocks in while we're trying to stay afloat. So I think it's pretty astonishing the fact that your projected plan actually is projecting out much further than it was originally anticipated for stability. And we are, as Councilor O'Donnell pointed out, we're remarkably stable and robust by comparison to especially the other communities that you showed. At the same time, we still sit here with quiet desperation. So I'm grateful for the presentation. I'm grateful for your good work. I'm frustrated as hell. MMA did not make me feel particularly hopeful about the prospects. For some reason, most of the participants within the 495 loop, they were more than delighted with the governor, and in fact actually thought the governor's plan was the best thing to come down from the mountain, at least the ones I talked to. And that was somewhat frustrating because for some reason, as I've often pointed out, that, you know, as our voices get fainter and fainter as we exponentially pull away from, as the distance down the pike becomes greater. So I wasn't quite as heartened. The MMA always gives me the blues.
I have to give the governor some props, at least on the local aid, because there was always this, and this happened under the previous administration, like revenues would go up like 4% and we got a level funding in our UGA account. Like, so that was like a real frustration. Like, how can you tell us that state revenues are up and you're not increasing our aid? So, you know,
okay, tapping to the revenue increases.
We appreciate that at least that has happened, but that's such a small, minuscule
account. It's crumbs compared to the significant deficit that had been established. But you're right. Yeah. And being grateful for that. We're grateful that they stopped hitting us. I mean, that's not
the problem. Problem is the Chapter 70. Really, the legislature is really going to have to, you know, they're going to have to amend that law in order to make the change that we need.
And I don't
formula. So,
and the legislature, and I don't speak. I'm not referring to our legislators and our regional legislators who are actually, who are really great on all these issues, including the Senate President. But a lot of the legislators I hear, as I said, that's where the disconnect seems to be huge. There's a huge disconnect in their sense of what, how they can best affect delivery of services and generate revenue for this state versus what's actually occurring on the ground. And that's what frustrates me the most.
No doubt about it, yeah. And, you know, we have, and unfortunately, you know, you've got a you know, in the House, the speakers basically said the same thing as the governor, no new revenue. You know,
yeah.
No new revenues are on the table. So that's pretty much ends the debate. So that's the challenge. Because everything, all taxes originate in the House. So if the speaker says there's not going to be any revenue bills, then there's probably not going to be any new revenue bills. So.
In one question about growth, I mean, that is very impressive growth. And actually, I think, particularly in comparison to the other communities. Although growth has a kind of finite point. I mean, there is growth only can continue as long as there's
True.
Literally space that can accommodate that growth or the pressures that increase along with that growth. Do you have any sense based, you and Susan got a sense of how that projects out over the next 5 years, how our growth goes?
You know, we're doing, my economic development director, Terry Masterson, is developing some, you know, some economic indicators. We're actually going to be putting some of that information out pretty soon. He's been really trying to drill down into some of our, you know, everything from, you know, vacancy rates you know, attendance at all of our various venues and attractions and museums. You know, he's been trying to really get a lot of information on that. And in terms of, you know, people wanting to locate here, people who are contacting us, we are, you know, we're always getting contacted by people that are interested in locating, you know, their businesses in Northampton. And we've got, you know, there are several projects that are in the queue. We all know about the ones on Pleasant Street. You know, the two major housing projects, that's going to add to our tax base. We've got the St. John Cantius Church, which has a major redevelopment plan. We've got more, there's a whole other section, the back 35 acres up at Village Hill, which is permitted and is going to go into construction. So that's, you know, so we can see areas where there's going to be additional new growth. Obviously, you know, we're all waiting and wondering what the former Honda lot, now that the cleanup has been completed, what might be developing there. I don't think we have, you know, we are always talking with our assessors every year because they are really on the ground seeing this stuff and they're really looking over a lot of that data. So, you know, I can't really tell you what the trend's going to continue, but at least in the short term, we're seeing that it's going to continue to be strong because we can see enough projects in the queue out over the next 2 to 3 years that's probably going to keep us on that same path. Interest rates are still staying low, and so construction costs are still fairly low. So that's going to hopefully, you know, encourage people that want to do remodeling, even, you know, someone puts an addition on their house, that's new growth. I mean, that does change, that does get added into the new growth.
One last question, relative to that growth, are you seeing any trends in businesses that would contribute to the revenue and the jobs base of the community? Insofar as, is it service, restaurants, are they 501c3s, are they health services, is there a particular region that's showing more promise?
I think that's going to be something, I think, if you can wait a little bit when we do those economic indicators,
okay.
I think we're going to try to look at some of that data, like where the growth is in certain sectors. Certainly, we've seen an incredible growth in the medical sector because of the expansion of Bay State Medical Center's, you know, footprint and all these new practices that have been opened and, you know, the new Atwood Drive facilities, which have been built largely to house medical offices. And then obviously the old Price Chopper that's been redeveloped and now is medical offices. So there's definitely been a growth in the medical office sector in the health and health side. And obviously housing, we've seen a lot more housing starts. But I can try to, well, I think more of that sector specific information will be in those economic indicators.
I'd be interested in that. Also given the pressures on retail that people seem to be experiencing and the retail sales. And
I'll say, I mean, we have a fairly low, you know, the vacancy rates, with the exception of one particular property owner, are actually pretty stable. And we have, you know, there's, I don't know if you've been by Main Street, there's construction paper up at the old Deals and Steals, which, you know, somebody went out a little while ago. There's a new, a new store that's moving in. We just, you know, just had a, you know, the Verizon store just open at the old bank. Obviously, the new Birdhouse Music just opened where Iris Photo is. So there's still a lot of demand for people that want to open retail in Northampton. And so, again, it's all back to that whole rent thing that we've talked about. But
right.
But so I think there's still, I think this is still a very attractive and strong place to be. And people want to be here. And, you know, the growth numbers show it and all the other economic indicators show it. And we have great schools, too, frankly. Mm-hmm. I know we're talking a lot about cuts in schools and we're talking about, but we have really great high-performing schools. And our graduates go to some of the best colleges in America. So well, you know, a lot of people want to live here for that reason as well.
Downey said Massachusetts is the number one state in education.
There you go.
And if we were ranked with the rest of the world as opposed to with the rest of the country, we would be up there in the top, and Northampton's one of the top schools in that top state. So.
Definitely. Counselor.
I hate to interrupt all that, you know, positivity, which I agree with some, but there are, I have to point out, there are a lot of store closings downtown as well, and I think we need to keep that.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. No, that's definitely true. Yep. And but again, we're trying to work with property owners to try to match them up with people that are looking to locate here, because we do get a lot of inquiries from people that are looking to move to Northampton. So, any other questions, Councilor?
Yes, Mayor, I want to thank you very, very much for the presentation this evening. But it seems like every year we go through the same thing all the time of hearing about the charter schools. What is the problem? Maybe you could help me out with this, because I'm really having a problem with it. When many of us went to Boston, we went to the State House, we were very vocal about what needed to be changed. The formula is a big problem. What is the problem with the State House that they're not hearing what people are saying about the charter schools? It's caused a serious problem. What do we do here? We're put into a predicament.
Yeah, I think
that's not a healthy one here.
I think the challenge gets back to the issue that I mentioned and that Dr. Provost mentioned, which is, you know, the fact that the legislature doesn't fully fund the reimbursement every year. And the reason why they can do that is because charters don't affect every city. They don't have an impact on all 351 cities and towns in Massachusetts. They only affect communities that have, you know, a charter near them, and not every community has a charter. Northampton happens to be proximate to four or five charters, so we have a really large impact. There are lots of communities that this isn't even an issue. There aren't any charters near them, so it's not a major issue. So,
but he wants to expand it.
Well, there is a move. Obviously, it may be a ballot question. It may be a vote of the legislature to lift the so-called cap,
right,
which, again, as the Senate president pointed out in a great interview he gave the other day, that they're really, you know, if you're an underperforming district, there's no cap. You're actually allowed. You can actually start a charter school. The cap doesn't apply. So there's a lot of misinformation. There's also this supposed 60,000 child waiting list in charters, which gets bandied about, which the state auditor has done an audit of DESE's management of the charter program and has indicated that they're triple, quadruple counting kids, and that the vacancy rate, they don't even know what the waiting list rate is. So, I want to be clear. I know that for many parents, particularly parents who are in a community that have, you know, severely underperforming districts, that charters are an option. They want to try to get their kid into a better school. I get that. I just think that the way that the program has played out over time, particularly out in a rural area like this, where transportation costs aren't included and we're already in a declining enrollment area, it's really played out differently in different parts of the state. So that's why I'm heartened, at least, that Senator Rosenberg says we really have to go under the hood and rethink the whole program.
Definitely, I just feel we're
not
being
just
going to
raise the cap and let, you know, and just build them anywhere under the current system, the way they're funded, and the way that you know, looking at the demographics, does the demographics of a charter school, does it represent the demographics of the community that it's serving? are they serving the same number of ELL and low income and others, you know, categories that we serve, that we, you know, are they providing those same level of services? So there's some of those kind of comparisons that I think have to happen, and we'll see. You know, the governor is a big fan of charter schools. He appointed a education secretary who is comes from the charter school world, and they're big proponents of it. And so I guess what we have to get them to understand is that it's not a one-size-fits-all issue.
And that because it's hurting us.
Exactly, exactly. And you know, Northampton's not an underperforming district. We're not in a receivership. We're not in, you know, any of those circumstances. We have great schools. And so that's the other issue. So enough. I'll get off my charter school soapbox.
Just wanted to ask about regionalization of services and procurement. If we have a sense that we've kind of maxed out all possibilities there for cost savings.
Well, we're definitely in the regionalization area. We are, you know, we continue to look for ways to do that. Actually, you know, we added a couple more towns to our Veterans District last year. We've added a couple more town. Well, we added one more town to our sealer of weights and measures, which is John Fry, whose autograph you see on gas pumps all around the valley, and other scales. We've set up regionalization to serve those communities. We participate in, you know, regional buying, purchasing programs where we can. We tried to do regional electric aggregation that got shut down by the DPU, but we are going to take another look at that. So we're consistently trying to find ways to do that. You know, it's a little bit of a challenge sometimes because we're kind of the big fish and a lot of smaller towns, so some of the needs we have are different. We still have some partnerships with Amherst, for example, in our health department, with inspections and things like that. So we are constantly looking for ways to do that. So because it is a way to, you know, save money by sharing services that we all have to provide. I actually wish the state would start to look at innovations that could help communities, because, you know, we've got these 351 cities and towns, and we all have to do certain things, and we all have to do, and, you know, perhaps there's ways they can create systems that would make it easier for all of us, standardized systems. So I you know, we're always looking at it, but I wish they'd figure out ways to lift some of the burdens and give us, you know, create some regional systems. Other questions or comments? Or Dr. Provost, did you have any comments just about the school side or no?
No.
Okay. No happy news or anything?
No, I'm sorry, I'm unprepared for happy news right now.
Okay, the presentation is available on the website, on the city's website. It's
okay.
Under our budget page, if you can access it. So if you want to look at it or share it with folks or go back through, if you have questions about any of the slides, I'm going to try and get answers to questions that we did here tonight. And otherwise, I guess I would entertain a motion to adjourn this special
meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. And seconded. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Meeting is adjourned.